Namaste all. Welcome to today's Natural Eco Living webinar. And today is Natural Eco Living Group 87th webinar. And topic is how to make natural eco colors at home. And the presenter is Renika Vijayaraghavanji. And this is our second webinar from Renika ji. And today's agenda, I will quickly go through it. In this chemicals-based modern living, what is Holi? Why Holi? Ecology involved in this festival. What are the available options now in form of toxic chemicals and artificial colors for Holi or for coloring or for food and for herbals, and toxins in these colors and health damage it can cause and environmental pollution too. Now, natural colors available. What are the natural available colors available and how these can be made at a home as a simple process, DIY, do it yourself. And herbal values in these colors. Now, beyond Holi, what we can do with these colors as part of natural eco living. And lastly, we go through the question and answers and interactive discussions. Before that, I just want to give a brief introduction about Renika ji. Renika ji is an abiding interest in all the natural things. She has been leading a sustainable lifestyle much before the term became a buzzword, trying to leave as small as a carbon footprint as possible. She grows herbs and uses them in food, medicine, and grooming products. She is committed to exploring alternatives to chemical-laden products that we use every day. She spread the awareness regarding various aspects of living sustainably and conducts awareness sessions and workshops. Now with this, we welcome Renika ji. Renika ji. Now we have Holi is coming up and many people say we don't have a natural alternative to avoid the chemical alternatives. So now is over to you to please share your experiences with natural eco colors.
Sure. Thanks for the opportunity. Namaste everyone. Sudhir ji is doing a wonderful job quietly connecting people like farmers to people like us. He's doing everything in the backdrop, no one really not in the forefront. I think it's a huge kind of a contribution to society. It's bridging a very important gap that is there. We all want such stuff and he's exposing us to an array of things. Thank you, Sudhir ji, and thanks everyone for participating. And before we start, happy Shimga, happy Holi, happy Kamana Habba, as it is called in Karnataka, to everybody, and Ranga Panchami in advance. This is a really beautiful festival, unique to India, and it is celebrated differently in various parts. Like it's the harvest festival in some areas. In some other areas, it is celebrating the love between Radha and Krishna. And at other places, it could be the triumph of good over evil, as in the story of Holika. And also, another important aspect is for us to shed the baser instinct and go towards higher realms of realization, as in when Shivji was in penance, he gets angry and burns Kamadeva. So that is also remembered in certain parts of the country on this important day. On the previous day, it's very interesting to see how it is celebrated across India. On the previous day, there is a fire lit and there is a lot of things happening around it. In Punjab, they sing and dance around it. Here, in some areas, we offer Puran Poli and Prasad to the fire. In Karnataka, they offer Hulige to the fire. Western thought is it's a wasted food and they do not see the difference between fossil fuel being burnt and these organic matters being offered. So I feel, as in many other things, this also there will be a realization. We do realize, we see the difference, but the world at large will see the difference too, is what I feel. The fumes that emanate are not the same, that people realize, but there is no in-depth study there, but accusations are just flying around. That is the problem. And I feel festival as pious as Holi and as important as Holi needs to be celebrated with so much dignity and piety. Are we doing it is quite another question. Agreed, we are a colorful people. We love colors. India loves colors. And we showed the people of the world how to dye. Indigo nation, we were called. So there is a very interesting history to this. So blue was a very difficult color to achieve back in the days, say 200 odd years ago. So our indigo was trading at the price of gold. If you believe it, in Europe, it was as expensive. Only very well-to-do people could wear, you know, indigo bleached blue things. And what we're wearing even today, our jeans, has the origin connected with our indigo. Thing is, when this color went abroad, there was this a place in France called Genoa. And blue, the jean was the term, that is the blue colored cloth from Genoa was spoken like that in French, and that jean became the jeans that we are wearing today. So it is very interesting to see how we have contributed. And another aspect was we were forced into farming only for indigo, foregoing our food. We were not allowed to grow our food, if you believe it. This was during the British era for a bit. There was a huge protest against this. It was called the Neel against Neel in Hindi. And by and by, we got by, but these are things we should remember. Later, of course, the chemical color came. It was so easy to create any bright blue. That is the story that followed. And coming to the festival itself, who wouldn't be delighted to be, you know, showered with rose petals and smeared with sandalwood and turmeric? This was what was being done. And during our living memory, what we have seen is not at all what the festival intended to be. It is something else it has become. You know, we stooped virtually to chemical colors, which were very, you know, bright and much brighter than what natural dyes can produce. So it is terribly disregarding our personal, health. And also ecological concerns are huge, because whatever we throw around and put on one another eventually finds its way to the water bodies, whether it is the rivers or underground water. Also, of course, there's air pollution too. So we started using copper sulfate for green, if we please, and Prussian blue blue, which causes dermatitis. Copper sulfate causes allergies. Then we have mercury sulfide for red color. And asbestos, silica, you name it. And if you do you believe this, ground glass was added to the color just to make it a little more shiny. This, I think, is, I have personally seen people break open cells, batteries, and then, you know, smear it on one another's faces. It's a black or dirty black. And how low can we stoop? Is it becoming of a country like us? Who are we? We are world leaders in ecological living. We have lived such a beautiful life, taking every aspect of ecology into consideration. We don't ignore anything, not even the microorganisms, though we didn't have a microscope to examine them. But somehow these influences came and it happened. I think we have to, you know, get up from there and battle this out and get out of this zone. And how did this happen, if I may ask? You know, it is us. We allowed it. We never bothered to ask what went into this. How did you achieve this blue or no labeling? And why do we see? We cannot control everybody. We do not want to control the world. we only want to work on ourselves. But unless we have the right to refuse to buy, if there is no labeling, proper labeling, and if they are not divulging the kind of information that we are seeking, we are free to refuse to buy. Even very huge companies, though they're not producing color per se, but for an example, Amway never discloses what, it may be patent, it may be their competition, and they want to cut one another's throat, but why should we be the victims here? So I think we have every right, and we have to exercise the right of refusing to buy things that are not labeled. And label reading is extremely important. It's initially, it is cumbersome, but by and by, you know, in a glance, you can make out that there is something amiss here. And, you know, the lesser the ingredients in any product, the better. So awareness is of utmost importance. And Sudhirji, you're doing an excellent job by, you know, exposing us to these things where, otherwise, unless there is awareness, we will never progress. We will remain with those chemical colors. So when these things get into water, is it easy to just remove it from there? And not at all. There is no sewage treatment plant that can get rid of these chemicals, because we don't even know what we have thrown in there. One, you know, very flavorful color, holy color, they add some terrible artificial flavors also there. So when you use that, there are 5,000 chemicals that go into one such artificial perfume. So these guys don't even know what they're throwing into the air. So we are also responsible. I own the responsibility, but the manufacturers do not know what the consequences are going to be, but we are just letting it go. So except a few sewage treatment plants, which are plant-based, nobody can remove everything. And the water bodies that look so attractive, the ones abroad, are also polluted. It's not like they're not as clean as they look. So, and you would say, why not? So this is artificial food color, we're eating it every day, so why not apply it on our faces? Sorry, no. Conscious people are not eating artificial colors. Those terrible colored cakes and pastries and stuff, many, many people do not touch them. So those colors are harmful. They could cause cancer. It could be, you know, a child becomes like hyperactive with such kind of things. There are many other known problems with these colors. Appreciating the real colors, and natural aromas and flavors is so important. I feel we have to look within. When we meditate and when we are more aware of ourselves, we are in a better position to judge these aromas, these colors and flavors. Our senses are more tuned and sharpened in that area. And we're today going to look at some alternatives that we have in our hands besides these chemical things. And I feel the baseline should be, we will not put on our skin what we don't put in our mouth. So only if you can eat it, you'll be able to apply it on your face is what I feel should be the baseline. I think the chemical stage is gone. You know, we can feel it in our bones. There is a change coming, and we are part of that change. I think we should be very proud to be there and take this forward. And our country is so crazy bio-rich. We're so rich. The material available to us is enormous. So it is up to us to tap them, look around for them. I'm sure after this session, all of you will, you know, think about various ways of getting things together, your own permutations and combinations. I'm sure you'll come out with many other ideas as well. I'm going to give you but a few ideas. There are many, many ways in which we can use this bio-rich material. For example, what I'm wearing just now is Malotus philippensis. It's called Kamala. It's a natural color. It's a blood purifier. See, when you apply these things, you are virtually giving yourself a spa. You're not throwing some dirty stuff on one another. And what about haldi? See, applying haldi, it's a beautiful thing. We do it before weddings. Why not do it during Holi? Why do you need that artificial color? And it's a smart way of warding off infections also. And you can use it dry. You can, if you want to let it go in the air, you could do that. You can apply it as a, mix it in water and throw it. There are other festivals in Tamil Nadu also where they throw yellow water, this haldi water on one another. It could be in the form of a paste and applied. And you tired of yellow, just a small pinch of chuna, slaked lime in it, and it becomes red, beautiful red. So you can use that red, okay? If you want to do, it's always fun to explore a lot of possibilities. This ordinary henna that we put on our hands and in our hair, you soak it for a bit, like 3 to 4 hours in water. It gives a different red, not that chuna haldi red. This is a different red, a maroonish red you get. That's a very beautiful color. Then we have hibiscus flowers. We could use that. In fact, the things that are wasted after use, wasted in the sense, there is nothing wasted in nature if you actually go to see. So the things that you could be composting, or just putting it away, those things could be used. That is the way to go, is what I personally feel. And then then there's manjishta. There is one herb called manjishta, which has a beautiful shade. It can even be used to color your hair. It gives a reddish tinge, and not the orange tinge that mehendi gives. So that is another option that could be mixed in water and used. Of course, cost is a factor that we will have to consider, and so ways of using other things and waste and whatever. Actually, it's not right to use the word waste in the natural world, is what I feel, but that it's conveyed easier when you say waste. So yeah, and there is gulmohar. Gulmohar gives a beautiful color, but and jacaranda gives a beautiful purple, bluish purple. But these two species are not a great idea to grow because they are not indigenous species, and they are not a very good option. We have many other things. You could grow henna, you could grow. I think the way to go is grow these things in our societies. If we could encourage people to plant these things instead of crotons and ornamental plants, it will be a great idea. They look very good, and we could always think of schemes where, you know, you mix and match and it will look good. You can prune it. They are so adaptable. You can prune them. They just listen to you. So there are many ways where it can look good and it can serve your purpose. And when it is grown beyond a point, everyone is free to harvest from there. Societies should get together. In fact, we in our area, we have spoken to people around here, and I have helped them plant Ayurvedic trees. See, most of us can grow herbs on our windowsills and balconies, and if we have gardens in the garden, but trees are very difficult. We don't have the space for that. But when people come together, amazing things happen. And we have been able to plant many Ayurvedic trees around here. And then for a green color, there is neem. Neem, it's measles season around the Holi season. You know, I remember during exam season, people got measles. So this is a nice way of warding off measles and such germs also. Neem, and even palak gives a beautiful a green color. And there are so many things that we could have fun with. And then palasha pushpa, palash, that is, it's a beauty monosperma. That also gives a very beautiful orange color. And around the holy time, people drink thandai, the one which is made with badam and khaskhas and things like poppy seeds and things like that. This could be used to color the thandai. It looks very nice. And it is actually had as a juice also. This it's very cooling to the body. And there are several other medicinal uses here. And the list is huge, but I'm just about touching on a few. There is for golden yellow, pomegranate peels give a beautiful golden yellow, and the color is quite fast. It doesn't fade, means the clothes that you wear will have to be discarded in all probability. And then there's a very interesting herb plant, Basila alba. It's called Basile Soppu in Canada. It's Mayalu in Marathi. So these greens, I've got some to show you. These are beautiful green, and they give, you can add them, grind these leaves fine and strain it, and then mix it with either rice flour or arrowroot powder or cornstarch, and then dry it, shade dry it, because if you dry it in the sun, there is the possibility of fading. So if you shade dry it, then you get such stuff. You know, things like this, they become little biscuits like this. And when you just run it through your mixie, you get a fine color like this. You could add neem in this, to change the colors. You can experiment with the 100 things. It's so much fun. And this is beetroot. Beetroot also can serve this purpose. You can extract juice and do it. You can directly spray the juice around. All possibilities are enormous. And another very interesting thing we could do is, you know, before I forgot this thing. See, the same Basila alba yields these fruits. Little seeds there. When you just put them in water and extract, as you would extract tamarind, imli juice, how do you extract? Just like that you do with this these seeds. You get a beautiful purple. It is possible to do a monochromatic, single-colored painting with it. Water, it behaves just like watercolor. And you can make a juice out of this and drink it. It's very cooling for the body. Normally, we just throw it away, such things, just because we are not aware. We just discard it. So it is a very cooling drink too, and looks terribly attractive. The color is very, very nice. And normally, this color is difficult to get from many other sources. So this is a unique color that you'll be making it. Growing this is a fool's game. It's very difficult to kill this plant, actually. It grows like wild and propagates itself. You don't even have to, you know, plant another one. It's just these seeds fall and they're growing all over the place. There are varieties in this where there's a red-stemmed one, and this. We eat these leaves. These leaves are edible. We cook these and eat them. And as for the colorful, see, during Holi, they not only throw colors at one another, they smear one another with colors too, and, you know, throw it around. So another possibility is pastes for application on the, they put tilak also on one another, they apply tilak on one another. So another possibility for this kind of paste will be, there are some beautiful coloring agents which will give off color only in fat. Only in oils and fat. So this is alkanet. So if we could, you know, just heat oil and introduce this in the oil, your oil will get colored. As with all things, we cannot overuse anything. You cannot have this is edible too. If you want to color your pickle or something like that, just to make it very attractive. Like how these hotels put some terrible artificial colors. Instead of that, once in a while, this can be used for that also. The botanical name is Alcana tinctoria, and it's commonly called Alcanet, and it will give out a beautiful shade when you put it in hot oil or any kind of hot fat, ghee or any butter. And we could mix, say, manjishta or this kamala in it and use it as tikka. And there is another very interesting seed called annatto seeds. They are like this. How do I show this? One second, I'll show it in my hand. Okay, how can you put it in a polythene bag or something? I'll just, you know, take help to put it in a Ziploc or something and show you guys. Because I'm not able, it's so tiny, I cannot hold it up. This plate is just sliding down. So this also is another color which when introduced in fat gives out a beautiful orange red shade. It is used in cooking in other parts of the world too. This is a foreign origin. It grows well in our, I grow it for that matter. And it is a beautiful tree to look at also. So worthwhile growing this too, though it is not totally indigenous. And this kind of, we are all familiar with coffee painting, which is very much in vogue nowadays, you know, a monochromatic in different hues and tints it is painted. That kind of painting is possible with this. And when, as we're getting ready with those annatto seeds, another thing I would like to talk about is, this is, let us, why limit ourselves only to holy and food? We can, you know, dye our clothes. You know, it's so much fun. I have done it in the past. Dyeing your own tie and dye dupatta. Make your own tie and dye dupatta. You can make, tie little knots on the on a piece of plain cloth and dip only the portions that are not tied into the solution. One of, choose any one of these that will lend themselves to cotton, say, and do it. It is a great fun activity. And also our hair colors, the ones that are sold in the market are so full of chemicals. They damage our eyes, they damage our hair. A lot of other skin issues also because of that. So a very good idea to dye our hair would be mehendi, of course. But if mehendi is followed with indigo, the indigo that we, it's called neel in the local languages. So with neel, it gives a beautiful shade to our hair. And also, you see, for people who prefer reddish shades, it could be manjishta. Manjishta is another very beautiful color. And to fix these colors, be it for hair color or for clothes, there are mordants, which are the color fixers. These are substances that help fix the color. So one such mordant will be haritaki in Sanskrit. It's called hirida. And in Tamil, it's called kadupai. So when this is powdered and used along with the colors, it fixes the color better. Amla too helps in that fashion. Actually, we know haritaki, hirida as a component of trifala, and the health benefits, it helps with allergies, and it's a mild laxative and things like that. But if we think a little out of the box, we could be using it in many other ways. So here comes the annatto seeds. See, the seeds are like this. And they give out color when you introduce them in hot oil. And it's great fun to see the color releasing there. The botanical name here is Bigza ornella. Bigza. I'm only giving you the botanical names so that we have no confusion about the species. I have no other intention. I'm not a botanist. I can't say this enough. Like, it's very important for us to grow these things, because many species are going extinct. And as home gardeners, we can contribute in these small ways to keep them going, at least not let them go extinct. And many of us have connections with farmers. So this is a very good proposition for them to grow these things. And because we are, our exposure to these natural things have become so minimal because of our the concrete jungles and our city living, that these things are being lost. And once it's lost for one generation, it is quite likely that it is lost forever. So if we could connect with farmers, so they will also get a better price than growing some local vegetable or something maybe. So mixed cropping and using these plants also to encourage them to get better profit margins and things like that will be a nice idea to consider. I would like Sudhirji to think about this. And I feel, thing is, the group here more than us, I think the children and maybe the grandchildren are the ones who are going to play Holi and enjoy themselves. I think, please, if you could sit them down and explain to them these aspects, the various aspects that we just discussed, I think it will be a great thing. And it's a fun activity, and it is, after all, they are the future. And it's about conservation, it's about ecology. I think it's time they participate and know about it. And lastly, I would like to say social distancing still is very important. Many of our states, we are doing, it's not very, the picture is not very pink. So please look after yourselves and place safe is what I would advise. Thanks a lot for the patient here. And I'm here to take your questions, waiting. Yeah.
Thank you, Renika ji. We have a couple of questions in the group chat, and many few members also want to discuss in person also. Yeah, yes. You mentioned about the seeds. Can you please post that name so that anything in the
chat?
Yeah.
Just hang on 1 second. Now let me figure this out. Yeah. I'm sorry, I'm bad at this.
Yeah.
So you have to go for the chat.
Maybe we can send it in the group later. So now the question is, any suggestion for getting a pink color in the fat base, oil base?
Pink in the oil base. Okay, ah. 1 second. Let me get my picture back. Just hang on. Okay, do you hear me still? Because I can't see myself.
Yes.
You hear me?
Okay. Yes.
If we could lighten that color with some flour or any white, say with samjira, there's something called samjira powder that is available in the market. When you add white to a red, it becomes pinkish, various shades of pink. So it will be possible to add a white like samjira, samjira powder. It's a very innocuous substance which is mined. I make my own talcum powder and all these grooming products. So this is one of the things that I use, and I find it very good on the skin. So if we could, I've got a chat box. You want me to post the names here or later?
Yes, Jay.
Okay. So adding some white will make it pink. That's the easy trick.
Okay. So there is another one, Basila alba or Malabar spinach, what we call it.
Yes.
Leaves for green and the seeds for purple.
Purple,
these are the seeds.
Yeah. Gives a beautiful purple.
Yeah. So as I understand, we can make colors from the leaves, we can make colors from the seeds, from the roots and barks. And
you can, add essential oils to them and make them smell so good. And essential oils necessarily ward off pathogens and other things. It helps in that fashion also. So why not add some jasmine oil, some rose oil, some bergamot? It will smell, it will be a royal holy, I must say. And another thing is in your purple, this thing, your Vasala alba, we can add some kokum juice, you know, soak kokum. Kokum is a souring agent from Maharashtra. It gives the same color. So if you make it a little acidic, it's even better on the skin. So you will be giving your friend a spa if you throw this juice with some kokum in it.
Okay. So you mentioned from beetroot powder and amla powder, you can mix some rice flour or arrowroot powder.
Yes.
Can you just explain a little bit about that?
Yeah. So we just grind this like we grind chutneys.
Yes. We'll make a paste.
And strain it.
Okay.
Get a clear green juice, a very nice green. Add rice flour in it.
Okay.
And spread it on a surface which is, you know, slightly oiled or... so that you are able to remove it on a plate which has oil in it, and then when it dries, please do not expose it to harsh sun because it could take away some color. So when you do that, you get these little flakes of green colored rice flakes or whatever you have put, arrowroot or something. So when you grind this, just run it. It takes like less than a quarter minute. Run it in your mixer and sieve it, and you get this kind of powder, green powder.
Okay. Yeah. So we need to add that to the flour and let it dry in shade dry, and then powder it again.
Okay. Yeah.
So for making oil based colors, which oil used to be used?
It go according to the season. For holy time, it will be coconut oil.
Coconut oil.
In the north, if it is very cold, their own oil, till oil or mustard oil. So it has to, you know, we have to treat our body with a lot of respect and the respect it deserves. So we are not made of some metal or something. So if we are sensitive towards our body and use things that are suitable in that particular season, you are rewarded with good health, is what I strongly feel.
Okay. So when we can make colors from the plants, what about the grooming, like a lipstick?
Oh, of course, I make my own lip balms and lipsticks and talcs and creams, all from natural products, natural colors, natural base, nothing. If you know many Ayurveda products, hair oils and things that are popular in the market, are about 40% mineral oil. You will be shocked. That's why I think it's very important to read the labels. And if we feel that some FDA is going to come and protect you, sorry, that is a really subpar organization which doesn't care about what goes into what. They are only dealing with additives and colors. They have some regulation. There also, they are not strict about it, and they are not totally above board there also. Only just about superficially that is monitored. The main ingredients that go into a product is totally left to the producer, the manufacturer, to do what you want. So it's a sad state, and we are responsible. So unless we put our foot down, things will continue like this.
Yeah, true. I mean, nowadays mineral oil is very, very cheap, and it will give more margins to them.
Yes.
So, but it's sad that even Ayurveda products are adulterated with mineral oil.
Yes. Yeah. And the colorant there, I don't want to name these. We don't want to fight with anybody. We want to get around this and somehow protect ourselves, and like-minded people get together and do better. And all our energies in some positive way where we can produce something nice, we can help one another and get along. Yeah. I'm surprised to know that... the color that distinguishes petrol from diesel, some petroleum colorant is used for that color. And why is this happening? Because we want some colorful oil. It's not enough if it is if it serves the purpose. It has to be colored and flavored. Okay, take it. They'll put some petroleum colorant and some artificial flavor, which will have 5,000 chemicals, and we want to apply it on our hair. And it is advertised in such a huge way. that we fall for it. We feel that is the best.
Yeah, true. So regarding the flours, you mentioned about the arrowroot powder and rice flour, cornstarch flour. Any other flours we can use which is handy?
We can't use wheat flour because of the gluten. It will become gooey.
Hmm.
I think cornstarch, we can do one thing. Marigold powder, beetroot powder, palak powder is readily available in the market. You can just use them for people who do not want to, make it at home. That is another big possibility. And please ask me what you wanted to ask again, please.
Yeah, what are the powders we can use, like a rice flour?
If you want to make a yellow colored base, use besan. So go nearer the color as possible, as close to the color. Suppose you mix marigold, jendu, in besan, it will be better than mixing it in something white. So it will yield a better color. So just use your imagination, you're free. I always feel that this is one area where nobody is questioning you. Nobody will say, you're a girl, you wear pink, you're a boy, you wear blue. We will do just what we please and break all the rules. That is what we are here to do. So you're free to experiment. Jwari atta, why not? Of course you can do it with jwari ka atta. It doesn't do that, it doesn't have gluten. So just enjoy yourself. Bajri atta can be used in a greener thing, so because the base will make it, more vivid. The color will become more vivid. So we are free to experiment. This is one area where no questions are asked. Men should wear only, spicy fragrances. Women should wear flowery. We can break all those rules here.
Okay. Yeah. And one more question is, For ingredients for the making lipstick.
Ingredients for lipstick. Again, it is enormous. The possibilities are, it depends on, I personally feel we should use what is grown locally, the nearest to your home where you're making it. For me here, it is a kokum butter, it is coconut oil, it is castor oil. And for coloring, we have annatto, these colors lend themselves. You can use this as an eyeshadow, the green color, the blue colors. It's free to experiment. A castor oil, this kokum butter and coconut oil and annatto seeds, which give out the colors, and manjishta. I love the color of manjishta, and it makes a beautiful lipstick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, participants, if you want to ask a question, please raise your hands and unmute yourself, and we'll take a couple of questions. So these are the annatto seeds, what you are selling, saying,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Oh, this is gongura seeds. I mean, rosile seeds.
Not gongura. Gongura also is a nice color. That fruit gives a nice juice and it's very colorful. Yes, that also we can use. But this is not that.
Okay.
This is South American, if I'm not mistaken.
Okay. Yeah.
The origin. Yeah.
Right. So now the next question is, how we identify that the haldi is pure or adulterated?
I depend a lot on my biosensors, your nose and your mouth. If you're the more you practice and the more aware you are about it, you tell immediately one pinch. Most of the time you can catch it if you're attentive. Of course, there are many other tests which I have jotted down offhand. I cannot remember to see, especially putting it in water and seeing how it that if it starts giving out some color, then you have to doubt it immediately.
Okay. Yeah. Another answer is that buy haldi from the trusted sources so that 99% of the problems are got solved. Yeah. Now
we get machines that grind haldi at home. So that is, I was looking at that option, but I gave up because I thought I'll be taking on too much, more than I can deal with. So yeah.
Kriti Jainji, please ask your question.
Yes. Hello, madam. Myself is Kritish Jain. I'm from Coimbatore. So I'm working in natural dyes from past 2 years. Wow. Like I'm making garments and everything, but not directly. Like I dye with the units and then I make the garments and I sell it. So now I want to start a CSR activity, like an NGO, because I'm like, it's a social entrepreneurship company. I would like to educate in schools in Coimbatore and everything for natural dyeing. So it's like how I have so many questions because the normal market dyeing industries are all commercialized. So they, whenever I walk into a natural dyeing unit, they treat themselves as a patented technology and they don't share the details of how it is done, what is the process and everything. And so many times all the garments and all the its damage is there and we face a lot of loss. And there is no transparency. If I want to connect with schools to start clothing in natural dyeing, they don't, I mean, like they ask, they want us to be transparent and I don't have a dyeing unit yet. So how can I start one, like just for the schooling thing?
Okay, you want to actually teach it in the curriculum or this is an extra
teaching? I'm into organic farming from past 2 years. So okay. Since I was in this industry, then there was a lot of issues which we faced because of the natural dyeing units. Everybody's focused only on export. Mm-hmm. I focus more on localization, it's like mm-hmm. sustainable living mm-hmm. and local consumption. And so that I left that industry for 2 years mm-hmm. and I did organic farming. Mm-hmm. So now I'm a certified organic farmer and permaculturist. So now we have bought a piece of land which I would like to cultivate the things also. Plus in Coimbatore, only Coimbatore I want to focus. Then if I be successful over here, then people can come and adopt this model elsewhere. I don't need to expand.
Put you in touch with a couple of people who will be very useful in this area, number one.
Yes.
And
yes.
Secondly, I have a feeling it also depends on the marketing. So back in the days, there was a kind of a natural dyed clothing, which was called Bleeding Madras. It was actually called Bleeding Madras because each time you washed it, it would bleed. It would give out some color. That was very fancy. It sold very well. So there are so many aspects. If you want to sell your commodity, there are so many aspects which you have to look into. And I think it's very sad that people want to keep everything so secretive and not divulge it, though it is going to benefit all of us. I will try to put you in touch with a couple of people who will definitely, one of them could be influential in that area also. So I'll try to put you in touch with them. I hope it works for you.
Yeah. Kritish ji, please connect with us in WhatsApp. We have a few NGOs who are working in the rural areas on the cloth dyeing with natural colors. We will definitely will connect with the right people. Yeah. Next question is from Hypoonji. I didn't see your name. Please unmute yourself and ask the question. The display name is iPhone. Yeah.
Hello, ma'am. Hello. I'm Mona Muchandi from Mumbai. I have a question. What are the natural ingredients for the hair dye and exact proportion?
Okay. Exact proportions, I may not be able to tell you offhand because I don't have such a big memory bank. But the ingredients are very flexible. If you want a dark color, suppose you color your hair with henna, that is mehendi, today, and tomorrow you color your hair with indigo, that is neem, it will give a beautiful dark shade. And if you leave it, it has to be left for a couple of days, like 48 hours, for the color to develop. So after 48 hours of dyeing with indigo, it will give a beautiful dark shade. And this is according to preferences. So play around. I think you should do your little experiments. Fix it with that Hirda and see how it works. Add Amla, see how it works. Use a little more hard water and see how it works. These are little experiments and depends on your hair quality and the color you want. It's a very, fluid thing.
Okay. Yeah, I will take the next question from Neelajji. Neelajji, unmute yourself and ask the question. Yeah.
Yeah. So, Renikoji, it's like I'm preparing the natural, let's say the home care products, okay, without any colors or anything, additional colors, okay. Yeah. The one problem which I'm getting, it is like the people are tend to have, because the natural, the color keeps on changing, okay.
Yeah.
It is all the orange based, okay. Let's say like the bioenzyme based or something, okay.
Yes.
But the problem which the people face it, or the people says that it is not, the color is not consistent. Today the orange could have a green color, and tomorrow it could have a dark brown shade or something. It comes out. So how we can do it like a consistent color? Because I don't want to add any additional color, as we mentioned that it has a lot of chemicals into that thing, okay. But how to make like a consistent color into that thing? Any suggestions or anything to that thing?
First and foremost, people have to accept the fact that if it is a natural product, there are bound to be variations. How come that Fab India is able to say this is a natural handmade product and there are bound to be variations in the weave and dyeing, and this is the wash care? There you are accepting just because they are established. But you are saying from orange to green and all, normally it doesn't go so, from orange to green, it doesn't travel. So I think there is something, for how long do you keep this? What is the shelf life?
No, so the shelf life is like, because it's a bioenzyme based, okay?
Huh.
So what happens, like whenever I procure from the oranges from the farmers or anything, okay, so let's say the one time when I'm procuring, the oranges could have a green color. Definitely it will not have the 100% green color, okay. But let's say if I take it from the mid of something, summer, okay, then it could have something, the yellowish color or the orange color.
Yeah.
Okay, so the batch wise the color will change.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, but the problem is like with the liquid, the people are okay. But when I sell it as like a toilet cleaner or something, the people get annoyed with that particular color because it is come something is like the yellowish or something. And then the people raises the question.
That's the whole problem. Like awareness is lacking. We have to spread this awareness. You can easily put some color there and say every day look in this color, which is not what we want to do. So I don't think, each batch, each orange peel or whatever you use for the enzyme is going to be different. So how can you standardize it?
Correct.
We want to standardize everything. There lies the problem, is what I strongly feel.
Yeah, that is the reason. I am not adding any additional color to that thing. But the customer asking is like, so this is changing. How your thing? It's natural. You do not have been.
I don't have this problem in my natural grooming products that I make. It could fade a little bit. It doesn't become from green to orange. And
no, yeah, no, it will not be green. It will not be green, but it will be a variation to the yellow. So, so it will be like yellow to a little bit brownish, not a 100% brownish, but mittika color or something.
You're talking bioenzyme now, right?
Yeah.
I don't think you can standardize the color of bioenzyme. Even if you're using the same oranges from the same field, it may not be true to the color or through the
year. Correct.
Yeah.
So anything like which we can...
Lots of awareness programs you have to conduct across and show people that if you want real stuff, this is how it will be. If you want orange color through the year, we can always add this.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you all. Thanks, Rinkaji, for joining us today's webinar and sharing your experiences with our making natural eco colors. And definitely, it will be useful. And many people now can experiment how to make these colors for holies to start with. And Those who are not part of a natural cooling group, please see the group chat. We have shared the links. And those who are looking for a natural turmeric pod also, see the phone number and WhatsApp. And in the groups, we are going to share the few videos where we have elaborately discussed how to make these natural colors. And also, we are going to share the list of the herbs, what we have noted in this webinar. So don't miss. If you're not in the WhatsApp group, please join. And thank you all. Thank you, Renika ji, for today's wonderful, colorful and webinar. And hope we conclude this today's webinar. And thank you all.
Thank you very much. Thanks all. Thank you, Sudhir.